Hey, welcome back to the episode of the podcast. What the hell happened to my voice there? Anyhow, welcome back to the episode of the podcast. I'm Sandeep Rao, and you're Sandeep Rao. And I recently read this book, guys, where it's so-called, quote-unquote, science fiction. I don't believe in that. I think it's real. And that's what makes the book even more interesting. The possibility of it being real is so much more disappointing than it actually being real. So read fiction like it's fact. Makes life interesting, because I think more and more we need to push the boundary of what excites us, because the real world itself, when you hear the news, sounds like fiction. So might as well make fiction fact, and that way we can push the envelope of human potential, and that way it can make people aspire to be bigger assholes and do crazier things. Because come on, the news nowadays, fucking mass murder, crazy. I've seen it. I need it in books now. I need aliens to come pretend that they're retrievers, golden retrievers who are committing mass murder, something like that. But this book I read, I forget the guy's name, he's a screenwriter for Hollywood. He writes this book, and in that, this guy comes face to face with himself in parallel universes. Now, that's interesting, right? If you can meet yourself in different versions, in different realities, in different possibilities of your life taking different paths that you didn't take in this life, but you only know it as this Sandeep Rao, or this Hemant, or whatever your name may be. I don't know why Hemant cropped up, but hey, if you're Hemant and you're listening, hey, I'm a big fan that you're a big fan. Hey, lovely. But if you come face to face with these multiple versions of yourself from multiple worlds, I think it'll just give you perspective of where you are, because you might meet a richer version of yourself. You might meet a more abusive person of yourself, version of yourself. You might meet a more kind. You might meet a bigger asshole. Who knows? The possibilities are endless. But wouldn't it be fantastic if we can all have that one moment in our life where we meet our other versions, our other selves? Not called it versions, are other selves who exist and are living right now as we speak, or as I speak to you. I hope you're not speaking, because I'm speaking to you and you're speaking at the same time. It's a conversation which isn't happening, but it's distracting for both of us, because I can't hear you and you can hear yourself, but not me. And that's kind of pointless when you're listening to a podcast. Anyhow, so I think this will give us a sense when we meet our thing. Have a yearly annual meeting, like how you have a corporate day, an annual day, or you have a update or a review at whatever company you work at. Have a review with yourself and with yourselves, and just say, hey guys, this year I've done this with the circumstances, with what I've been presented. What did you guys do? And you all walk out of that meeting every year, go back to your different worlds and exist for another year until you meet yourselves. That way, most importantly, you're liable in 1 year's time for your actions to yourself and selves. And that way, collectively, as a community of yourselves, you make a better world in different worlds. Interesting thought, right? Because when you read about human history, you hear about the nomadic ways, the hunter-gatherers would seek community, right? We would travel in these tribes, we would hunt and gather, and we would raise children together as a collective. But it's because I think we had fewer people then. The opportunity to meet people and come together was much, much rarer back in the day. You had to walk 100 miles, in the middle of which you'd have like crazy things. You'd have saber-toothed tigers, or you'd have G.I. Joes, or you'd have mammoths, or something would come. Maybe no food. Maybe a Swiggy didn't come in time. So that way you go hungry and you don't make it to the next 100-mile mark which you've set. Or maybe water will run dry. Who knows, right? Or you run out of beer. Fucking A. God forbid. But now, I was out yesterday, and I just was amazed with the way humanity has taken over, man. I feel bad for the pigeons, not pigeons so much, but the parrots and the pigeons and the dogs. It's just, we don't have the need for community. I think we have the need for space. Back off a little bit, because it's too many fucking human beings wherever you look. And I'm using both hands, if you've noticed today, and that means I'm really emphasizing on this need for space. And this whole call for community and camaraderie and feeling together, fuck it, we don't need each other. We just need some time to ourselves. And I think this plan I have of meeting your different selves from different worlds, and every year you get a chance. Think about how lovely this is. Instead of going to Goa, going to Ibiza, wherever you're going, fuck it, you're going to a different world, which is the same world, but a different world with different results, different conditions playing out in different ways. So in this world, we might have the war in Ukraine, we might have COVID. In that world, you might just have, my God, the most amazing greenery, but still yourself there and the different versions of people over there will have problems, because as human beings, we love bitching about everything, right? What, the roads are so good, oh my God, but the trees are not green enough. What, the water is fresh and pure, but it's not cold enough. Oh my God, the women are so hot, but man, they're so clingy. It's never ending. So I think this yearly analysis, review, collective understanding of each of your versions or yourselves, having a meeting, walking out, going back to your worlds, you get a holiday, you get to meet yourself, you have a point of reflection, you have time to consider, and you also have a time to realize that your life ain't that shit, buddy. So hope my plan works, and I hope you are sold by my beautiful fictional plan, which is a fact. Let me move on to today's guest. Yes, that's what this is the point of. I've got Dr. Raquel Peel. I don't know why I spoke like that the whole time just now, but hey, it felt right. It felt neat. It felt right. It felt compelling, and fuck it, I did it. Dr. Raquel Peel is a researcher in the field of psychology. She's a relationship expert, an educator, a speaker. And in today's episode, we talk about a very important thing, I think, which is sabotaging, self-sabotaging relationships. We talk about the concept of interpersonal relationship, how it's transforming with the digital age, how it's transforming with the age of overexposure, information, selfishness. And of course, we talk about important things like bullying and suicide. It's a really fun, not necessarily fun, but it's a revealing, enlightening conversation with someone who's an expert in her field. So I'm sure you'll enjoy the conversation. Dr. Raquel, if you're listening, I appreciate you joining me. And to all of you listening right now, hey, as always, thank you so much. Till next episode, goodbye. God bless. Take care of yourself. Cheers. Lovely to have you on the podcast. Thank you so much for joining me, Raquel.
You're welcome. And thank you for inviting me to your show.
Yeah, I'm so keen to cover the topics of love and relationships, because I think so many people want to know, how do you feel loved? How do you give love? How do you keep that love going? How do you keep that momentum flowing? And in a world where you only hear the sensationalist news of people getting divorced, people breaking up, the messier the breakup, you have people not able to sustain a meaningful understanding with someone else. It's crazy out there. But let me ask you something before we go down that path, because there's a lot to talk about there. But from the research that you've spent the years focusing, what is keeping people together?
Well, that's a good question. I don't normally get that question to start with. What keeps people together? normally, people want to start with, why are people breaking up? Why are we not succeeding? But I love that we started with the positive. So, look, if I had to give you one answer, it would be communication. And I know it sounds easy for me to say, you've just got to communicate with your partner, but it's the absolute truth. And what I mean by communication is a lot more than just having conversations with your partner, is being truthful with what it is that you were actually looking for in the relationship. Mm-hmm. So if your partner does not know what your expectations of the relationship are, and you know, what makes you happy or what makes you tick, it's going to be an impossible task for them to be able to be in that partnership with you and connect. So I guess, you know, start with thinking about how it is that you communicate with your partner.
And I think that is, yeah, while it seems simple, I can vouch for the fact that it isn't simple, because you sometimes mention things that your partner, or you think that your partner might want to hear. You know, like my wife and I sometimes get into these moments of, like, let's call it a cold phase. You know, we don't really see eye to eye on what's going on. And, you know, many times they're petty issues, right? We have a 1-year-old baby girl. And when it comes to whether responsibility or taking things, she does a lot of the heavy lifting. I'm just playing a very minimal supporting role. But whether it comes, you know, to her going back to work, or whether it's, you know, the baby's not sleeping well. See, so these are obviously teething issues in all senses of the word, right? It happens to every parent. But when we catch ourselves arguing, sometimes, you know, I don't actually tell her what I'm feeling, or sometimes she kind of, just to sort of soften the blow, doesn't tell me what she's really feeling. And, you know, that kind of heightens the tension, right? Because the crux of the matter is something a lot deeper. And if you keep kind of brushing it off, then, you know, by the time it gets to the real issue, then you've just kind of spent maybe a week, maybe a couple of days, maybe, but a longer period of time. And by that point, I feel the issue is gone all over the place and you're kind of missing the real point. So it's really important to quickly get to it. And we never did, I mean, many, many years back, like we didn't really do that, right? We would kind of brush under the carpet and it would come out really vile and angry when we would address it, right? It would be a lot more heated. But now the ability, I think, it's not easy, but the thing to like, let's jump to it. You know, we're together for a much more fundamental reason. So let's, you know, put our egos aside as hard as it is. And let's try, you know, saying, okay, you know what? This was my ego talking. And I understand that, you know, I messed up or you messed up or it's much beyond what we actually are fighting about. But it's something which has been bothering us for months, you know. And yeah, it does, you know, evaporate once you kind of get to that honesty in whatever sense you can commit to that honesty, you know.
Yeah, and look, you've mentioned really important points there. One is that there is a difference between how we communicate what we want and how we communicate what we are feeling. So a lot of the times it's much easier for us to say, I want this, or I want that, or I don't want this. But if we try to actually explain to our partners what it is that we are feeling, mm-hmm. it makes it easier for them to understand how to work with us to get what it is that we want. And the other thing to remember too is that our wishes are fluid. So perhaps today you want something and you're trying to get that and communicate that, but that might be something completely different next week. And it will depend on you know, how much energy you have, what it is that you're doing, what you're dedicating yourself to. And we need to be flexible with the fact that relationships are fluid, our wishes. And we can't be stuck into thinking that we are always going to be doing the same things or behaving the same way and that works. It might not always work. And there is a give and take in how it is that we need to behave with one another to make it work.
Yeah. And, you know, just to give you sort of a sense of background, you know, like just to give my relationship as an example, you know, my wife's a very positive person, right? She's always been... you know, told to see the nice in people, to kind of be, you know, the benefit of doubt is always like, you know, the person's nice, something's just not working for them, they're having a bad day, or they just, you know, got up on the wrong side of the bed, whatever you want to call it. And I'm a very not positive person. In fact, sometimes when I see a positivity in her, it just pisses me off. I'm like, how can you be so positive all the time, right? Because she wakes up and she's able to start the day on, if not a positive tone, at least in a neutral tone, right? She's like, okay, you know what? But for me to just to get neutral, I need to do like, you know, so much work just to spend time in my own head to clear those thoughts and not have a negative notion when I either think of something or think of someone. So it's, you know, it's so different that two individuals like this are together. And, you know, sometimes when I'd go off on the spiral, I'm just saying things. She's like, you're just being stubborn about your bitterness. You are bitter. And, you know, for very different reasons, right? Because we're different people, and I'm not trying to make this about my wife and me, but I'm just saying when it comes to a relationship, very rarely are two people exactly the same when it comes to life experiences, what have brought them there. So how do they, you know, see this benefit? Because a lot of the times a relationship gets dominated by one person, either the I don't know whether it's a girl or the guy or the male or the female or in same-sex relationships, but whatever the equation is. But we end up seeing more and more now this inability to kind of find a balance, but it's always one person overruling or dominating the other person through their wishes or through their intentions. And it seems from the outside that relationship is fine because the other person is kind of submitted to this kind of dynamic. But on the inside, it's this pent up emotion which is not being expressed because the established order of the relationship is really not favoring one person, right?
Yeah, look, what you are describing there is different personalities, right? And you are going to have different personalities in relationships. You know, if you have two people or even more people in the relationship, everyone's going to be different, which means that each item of the relationship is going to express their needs and their love and their affection differently. And Look, I'm just going to be honest with you. Balance in a relationship is overrated, in my opinion. I think that you're never going to find a relationship that is 100% balanced, meaning that, two items in the relationship are getting exactly the same amount of love or attention or whatever it is that you're measuring. I don't actually think that's important because we all need different things at different amounts, different times. So again, it's about communicating what it is that you need. And it might be that one partner needs a lot of attention. They need to be told several times a day that they're loved. Whereas the other partner is someone who doesn't necessarily need that, but they need looking after in other ways. Perhaps they like their meal cooked for them, or they like their clothes folded a certain way, and that's how they feel loved. And the same goes for how we express love. I know that I express my love for my husband a lot of the times in the way that I cook meals for him and pay attention to what it is that he wants to have for dinner. And that might be different for someone else. And that's what I mean by looking for that exact equality and balance in a relationship is going to be problematic. We need to actually be looking for what it is that the other person wants.
I think that that's really important, right? Because you can seem like the perfect person, but if you're not addressing their needs, then I think that. But you know, the thing which I want to talk about is to get to this place of whether it's maybe not balance being the right word, but to even appreciate what that person does for you or recognizing what that person needs from you, it involves a level of displaying, if that's not the right word, just establishing, with your partner, this idea of, sort of showing your vulnerability, saying, this is my strength, this is my weakness, this is what I need. And in today's day and age, where everyone's trying to put their, their biggest smile, their strongest foot forward, and especially people meeting online and people meeting, with a heavy influence of social media, where you're sort of just shown, you have to show just you're always the happiest, you're always on the best holidays, you're never having a dull day. So with that kind of, narrative guiding a lot of society, how does someone, get to a place of being vulnerable? Because it's very scary.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And look, again, you've mentioned something really important. It's about feeling appreciated, right? However that needs to be expressed. So we all want to feel appreciated, actually. We all want to feel that we belong in the relationship and that we are actually seen, understood, loved. And most importantly, we want to feel that we are doing the right thing for us and for others. So it goes back to that communication and again, being really flexible in understanding that I'm going to communicate differently than you. And if my partner's not understanding that, then we need to have that conversation for, look, I communicate by doing this. And perhaps you're expecting something else. I might try to do that, but that's not my way. To communicate. And it becomes difficult when some people are starting relationships online. But at the same time, for some, it might be easier. So I know in my research, I've heard again and again that for some people, being able to connect over Zoom or even texting is easier for them. So they can actually express their feelings, they can talk about it, and it's not as overwhelming as it would have been if they were meeting someone at a bar. So I talk a lot about having personal insight into who you are as an individual to start with. So if you are someone who is looking for a relationship, but the bar is not your scene and you're not someone who can express yourself physically or verbally, perhaps you are going to be better off online. You are going to be better off in an environment where you can express your feelings in writing or in an enclosed space where you can be vulnerable.
But what about these apps that people meet on, like Tinder or Bumble, where people are, clearly a lot of people are hooking up and seeking partners, maybe, I don't know, short term, maybe long term, or these matrimonial sites, whatever it may be. How does that play into the equation?
I think again, it depends on the motivation for using those apps. And you will hear people tell you that they are looking for love, and then they go onto app and they meet people. And then when you actually start observing their behaviors and how they are interacting, I question whether they are in fact looking for love or looking to have hookup or relationship. And when it gets to the sticky bit where it's getting serious or it could potentially turn into a long-term relationship, something a lot more powerful, which is that protection mechanism comes into play, and it questions them and it makes them think on whether or not they want to, you know, be in the relationship long term. So what I mean by that is it's very easy for us to say that we are looking for love and engaging the apps or whatever mechanisms we can to find that. But it's another thing altogether to stick through those hard bits, those bits where we need to be vulnerable, and put the hard work that it does take to maintain relationships long term.
Right, which is a lot of work, and it's not as simple as as it seems sometimes. And you know, the thing is, in today's day and age, we were just talking before we started recording, everyone wants these concise messages, right, when it comes to how do I, you know, can you give a prescribed way? How do I fall in love? How do I stay in love? How do I not get out of love? So maybe before we go down that path, can you, through your work, what is, I mean, there's no easier way of asking this, but what is love?
Well, what I can give you, I can't tell you what love is, and I wish I could, because that will be different to everybody and to whoever is experiencing that. But what I can tell you is this: what we are looking for as human beings innately, whether we know it or not, is a deep connection with another human being. And that might be one person or two people. We want to feel connected. And we have that desire innately from the moment we are born. It starts with our caregivers. Then for girls especially, it becomes really prominent in our teenage years that we need to connect with peers. Then, of course, in adult ages, we are looking for intimate, romantic connections. But throughout our entire lives, we are looking for connections with others. So that's something that that can define love, and love in many different shapes and ways. But one very complex thing that surrounds that search for love is our desire to protect ourselves above all. So if we feel threatened during the journey at any point, we are going to look at ways of protecting ourselves as a priority to connecting with others. And that's when it becomes difficult to find love or maintain love or feel love. So if you are looking for my quick bite answers to, you know, what it is that we need to do as part of that journey, I can give you that, but that won't, you know, be enough to solve all the issues. Right. First of all, I think we need to take a really hard look on ourselves as individuals, not as part of a relationship, but just who we are, meaning why am I in this journey in the first place? What are the motivations for me looking for love? Am I actually serious about this? What am I looking for here? Am I protecting myself or am I looking to connect? And are there any fears that are going to stand as a barrier in the way for those connections? So that's, I guess, step one is, you know, looking at the mirror, asking those questions, being truthful with who we are and the, I guess, the scars that we may bring to those connections. And then it becomes a bit more complex. We need to think of expectations for the relationship and how we are going to communicate that. But, you know, step by step, I guess.
And, you know, the thing which I'm getting a sense of this is, you know, when you are with someone and you spend many years with them, they get to know you, you get to know them, you've dropped these barriers, there's a lot of, you know, understanding of fundamentally who each other is. So am I right in saying that, you know, at some point, you know, in an intimate romantic relationship, the person almost, you kind of take on a lot of the things that they are giving and you kind of let go of who you were, retaining some, of course, some the fundamentals of who you are, but you're not scared of kind of becoming someone else in the course of that relationship. And the person who's your partner also takes on things from you and lets go of something that they were. So as a result, you kind of become two different individuals who've taken from each other and given to each other. And as a result, have changed into this this new, I wouldn't say new being, but these two new individuals who understand each other and taken on each other in some way?
What you're describing is what I would consider a very beautiful part of being connected with another person. I would like to think that as individuals, we are ever evolving, and changing. And that's what I was talking about before in terms of we are fluid in even in ourselves and what we want and who we want to be. But I would like to think that because I do believe that there is always an element of vulnerability in relationships, I'd like to think that yes, there will be the element of changing and connecting with others that we might describe as give and take. So yeah, parts of you might be lost in that process, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. I actually do believe that we need to change, and sometimes we need to lose some parts of ourselves that are not working and that wouldn't work with someone else involved in our life. So I think sometimes we attach negative connotations with loss, but in fact there are things that we do need to lose to be able to be healthy with another individual. And again, I don't know what those elements will be for everybody, but it's understanding that as one person you can be many things, but when you connect with another, that's going to take different aspects of your life and personality to be able to be combined with that other being. And in a true healthy relationship, you start to think of yourself as a part of an item as opposed to just one single item.
So the thing is, many times I'm just going to continue on one more point when it comes to intimate relationships, because that's something, I want to move forward from there. When it comes to maybe, husband and wife or partners or whatever you choose to call each other, many times it's not just the two of you, right? There are things that each person is coming to the relationship with, whether it's family, whether it's close friends, whether it's ex-partners, ex-boyfriends and girlfriends, and you have a lot of life that you've lived, and sometimes that can't just be left at the door. It creeps up. It creeps up, and it makes life a lot more fun with insecurity, with mistrust and interference with other people. And you get jealous because certain relationship with a friend may be stronger or perceived as more intimate, and it might feel like your husband is relying more on that person, might be more close to his or her mother, or she might be close to her brother. Whatever it may be, these things. So how does that factor in? Because you in some sense are cannot disconnect from that, quote unquote network of what you've come to this relationship with. But how do you appreciate that this is something different from that? And how do you make your partner feel, you know what we have is different from what we've brought to the table?
Yeah, no, look, you're absolutely right. And it's a really important acknowledgement to make. It's never going to be just two people in a relationship. And that's why I often talk about it as in terms of items or components of an engagement. And you're right, it might be yourself and your partner, and then you have kids, and then you have parents, and you have friends. And I guess it's looking for that support network that makes your relationship healthy, that actually adds to your relationship as opposed to subtracting. And we all know that there are friends and family members that are not helping our relationship. And it's right. There are people in our lives that do not add to our successes, that do not add to the healthiness of our engagements and relationships. And in some cases, it's about letting those go. But most importantly, it's holding on to the people that support you. So we were talking about it before. I'm in Brazil right now. And the reason why I'm in Brazil is because I've got a really good support network here. So I have family in Australia, I have family in Brazil. And for me, it means that at different times in my life, when I need different types of support, I will be traveling between those two countries. We can't live without support. And if I can go back to my previous point, we are often searching for those connections because innately it's what we need. We need to feel that we belong and feel that we are loved. And it's not just romantic love, it's family love, it's parent love, I do believe it's not possible to be alone in that journey. We need others.
And that's why I find that fascinating, right? Sometimes when, I lived in the US for a few years doing my undergraduation, and then travel there once in a while, and of course traveled to the UK as well. I'm just giving examples of the people I met, and when I would go over to their parents' home, these friends of mine in college or university, it was very sort of just their parents. If they had brothers or sisters, it was just them, and I would find that very lonely in some way, because where I live in Bangalore, whether it's good or not, you always have, besides your parents and at some point grandparents, you always have like an aunt just dropping in the evening for coffee, or you go somewhere and visit someone. It's a bit annoying, I'll be honest with you, having it all the time, but for me it was this sense of and friends, of course. And I found the idea of visiting your family once a year for Thanksgiving, or living separately, I think there's some empowerment and some sort of independence in that, which is great. But I feel like even just as a husband and wife, like if you're alone all the time and then you bring a baby into this world and raising that child all alone, it gets pretty desperate and lonely, right?
And look, it depends, right? It depends on how the partnership was established. So for some people, there will be the numbers will be quite high, like you described. You'll be friends and family and aunties and grandparents, and they're lucky to have all of that. For some people, that support might be in a small family nucleus that will include mom, dad, kids, and a few close friends, and that's fine. You know, it's hard for us to say what good support will look like. I guess the important point is that we all do need support, however it comes. And I remember when I worked remotely in Australia through our rural communities, support for those people a lot of the time were community members, so not even necessarily members of their family or friends. It was, people at the grocery store, or church, or the local hospitals. So it's just having that awareness that however it comes, I do think we need to have some level of connection with others around us to help through the hard times and celebrate the good times.
Right, of course. Now, I wasn't saying one is better than the other. I'm just, this is what I was used to. And, in some way I was exposed to that, which was great, right? But I was just trying to put myself in that situation, going, can I live here, say, in a beautiful house, maybe in the suburbs, and you have the world of independence, right? But at the same time, what happens, I was talking to someone recently who's recently had a child, and he was saying, it's great. Being, he had his kid in the lockdown. He said it was just my wife, myself, and I. Sorry, not my wife. My wife, my child, and I. And what was nice is that we just could do what we chose to do when it comes to raising her. But the moment someone else comes in, like he said, after the lockdown, his parents came in, and then they started giving their advice. They're like, "You should do this. You shouldn't do this." And so I think. At one level, the support is great, but that support can easily become a little claustrophobic as well if you don't draw boundaries.
Oh, yeah, very, very true. And I think it will also depend at what stage of life you are with your kids. So perhaps when your kids are very little, you do want everyone around you because the more hands, the better, right? But I hear you. It gets to points in your life where you just want that routine. You just want to be able to do what works for you and your family, and it's overwhelming to have, a lot of advice around. So I can certainly see that with my young family. And I hear you being coming from, a culture where there are lots of aunties and uncles and grandparents around, and then moving to Australia and seeing it differently there. I appreciate the difference, but I think that I personally seek the different types of support at different stages of my life.
That's interesting. No, because more and more, I get a sense of. It's not my personal observation, but it's evident, right, that there are almost two realities that we're immersed in. One is, of course, the online reality of having this presence and this perception of so many friends and this network. You have groups you're part of, right? Whether it's on WhatsApp or whether it's on Snapchat, Instagram. I mean, the possibilities are endless. And then you have this thing, this sense of importance on those groups. You have, and if you're a popular influencer, you have 5, 15 million, 10, 100,000 followers. And maybe if your partner's as popular, then perfect, or maybe not perfect. But ever more there's this disconnect or there's this separation of what's happening online. And when you come back, come out of that app or come out of that platform, it's a different reality, right? Because from all aspects, like if you're getting that much attention for everything you're saying, and then you come back and your husband or your wife doesn't even listen to what you're saying, and you're suddenly like, hey, do you know who I am online? I'm an influencer. And, you know? So, and other, the flip side to that is while there's the popular people, there's also a sense of loneliness, right? Because how does someone feel that they can reach out to someone? Without, you know, because they're so scared to open up. So both those things are two, maybe might seem two extremes of the online sort of phenomenon. But what is happening? I mean, I don't know if I have a question for it, but what are we looking at right now today with what's going on around us?
Look, I'm hearing the same sorts of messages that you are describing. We are more connected than ever. We can connect with people in anywhere in the world at any time of the day. But that doesn't necessarily mean that we are truly connected in the sense that I also feel that we are very lonely as humans because those connections are superficial at best. We can spend hours online with millions of people, but if we're not connecting to a point that we are fulfilling, those desires and those needs that we have as individuals, it's not going to make us feel loved in the end of the day. So, yeah, you can talk to millions, but it doesn't not necessarily mean you're going to feel loved in the end of the day. So it's about searching for those meaningful connections. That are not going to necessarily come in numbers, but in moments in our lives. It's not 24/7, but meaningful moments throughout the day or throughout the week that can make us feel loved are the important ones, I would say.
Raquel, you mentioned a very interesting thing. You said one of the first things to look at when you want a meaningful relationship with someone you've met and someone you've spent time with is to take a good hard look at yourself. But increasingly, people are resisting that because a lot of times, you know, there's a lot of pain, whether it's from the past, whether it's self-inflicted, whether it's environmental, whatever the cause may be. Everyone has some form of pain, right? From whatever reason or whatever life experience. But when someone's not willing to look at that and they kind of use coping mechanisms to deal with that pain, whether it's drugs, alcohol, it could be so many things. How does one even say, you know what, I'm going to take that first step and look at myself? Because it's so easy to have support, which in this case sometimes is not the best kind of support, where people are like, no, it's not you, it's you're the victim in this situation, and it's so easy to point fingers. There's always someone who's the persecutor, right? There's always someone who has done something wrong to you for whatever reason. So how does that narrative affect a relationship or someone who's looking to get into a relationship?
Yeah, look, you are absolutely right. I'm often met with resistance when I talk about that first step, take a hard look at yourself, face yourself in the mirror. Because it's much easier for us to look at what others are doing and discuss how others could meet our needs and what it is that we need from our partners than it is for us to think of ways in which we might have to change. And for the exact reason that you've just mentioned, we are in this journey of connection with that ulterior motive of protecting ourselves. So we are going to do everything we can innately to protect ourselves in the first instance. And because by the time you get to adult stages, we have been hurt before, we have had some sort of pain or trauma in our lives. We have that history of knowing what hurt feels like and knowing what protection can give us. So I would say that most of us have that innate feeling. And when someone says to you, oh, look at yourself and think of ways in which you could change and better connect and engage in the world in a healthier way, our instinct is going to be, no, I don't need to change that. I don't need to touch things that are sore and re-experience them. But that's the one true way of making connections is to actually look at ourselves. Because in the end of the day, that's what you're going to need to do. And look, I don't know any healthy relationship that does not take a level of vulnerability. And to be able to truly be ready to be vulnerable will take that courage that you are likely or possibly going to get hurt at some point in your relationship. And look, that's okay. With hurt comes insight, comes wisdom. But I don't know that I can tell people honestly that there's not going to be pain.
Yeah, because that is something which you don't hear, right? Because everyone just wants to hear about the evenings with romantic dinners or holidays. No one wants to hear about the fights. And yeah, the another thing, you know, again, these are just observations. If they're wrong, please correct me. But when people go to find a partner, I mean, this has happened across the ages from any group, right? Like when you're younger or when you're older, you have this image or this notion of what your partner should be, what they should look like. This maybe even borderline fantasy or expectations, right? I want this person to have this kind of background. They need to have this kind of job. They need to bring this to the relationship. And a lot of it is you projecting either what you want, like idealistically projecting, but a lot of times it's also projecting your insecurities. I don't want this person to do this. I don't want this person. How important is that? How damaging is that? And how realistic is that?
Disney does not help us when it comes to partner expectations and relationship expectations, right? Because we are taught from very early ages that there is a happily ever after and we can find Prince Charming. But look, my message is going to be repetitive in the sense that there is going to be pain, there is going to be hard work if you are looking for a long-term, meaningful, loving connection with someone, which means that you are going to have to dig through some dirt, perhaps, to be able to find that person that you are looking for and find that beauty that love is and is described as. I don't know, get your hands dirty, I guess is what I'm trying to say here. Be ready to hear the hard truth. It's like when you go to the doctor and you're about to get an injection and you ask, oh, is that going to hurt? Yes, yes, it will. But it will be worth it, I guess, is my message.
Right, because rejection seems like a very scary thing, right? Because it affects people so profoundly. It could affect self-esteem. It could especially if someone's not had a good run with, you know, finding acceptance or even connection, and you know, now it's just a matter of getting swiped left continuously, or you know, getting you know. So that clearly does something to someone, because I totally get what you're saying, because I think you know, if until you are there, there's no point in having preconceived notions or projecting, if this happens that might happen. But clearly, you know, there, you know, these mechanisms of self-preservation do take a lot of getting over to kind of reach across the gap to connect with someone.
Yeah, look, don't get me wrong. Mechanisms of self-preservation and, you know, protecting ourselves are very important. You know, they're there for a reason. We do need to, if there is danger, an actual danger, we do need to protect ourselves and put that as our priority. But what I do see a lot in my research is huge potential for connecting, and that innate feeling of fear of rejection or fear of commitment and intimacy as a barrier to a connection that otherwise could have been quite meaningful and beautiful. So that's what I focus on. There are many relationships out there that simply should just not exist. And you know, if I was advising someone, I would say run and do protect yourself. So there are cases in which you should be protecting yourself and running as far away as you can from someone. But what I like to focus on is those potential beautiful connections that we might be missing out on because of that fear of commitment or fear of rejection. And as you put it really nicely, rejection is part of life. And for some people, they are going to experience rejection again and again and again, and for no good reason. You know, you might be a gentleman and you might be doing everything right in your first dates, and you might be getting rejected again and again, and that's just part of life. But I think that it's still worth it. You know, you get rejected for jobs, and it doesn't mean you stop applying for them. You know, you get rejected for promotion. Again, you still try to search for that position that you want in your workplace. Same with relationships. You might get rejected. But I do think that we learn from rejections and we improve, or we can improve and go again from a stronger standpoint.
Right. But, you know, there's a tendency when you get rejected, it kind of, you know, depending on your self-worth or self-esteem, that the rejection could hit really hard, or you could just brush it off your back, right? But I think the healthy thing is when you're able to look at rejection as a tool to look at yourself, saying, okay, this is who I am. Maybe that person wasn't for me. But the dangerous, or maybe the other side to it, is when you start becoming someone you think that people want you to be. And that's a very slippery slope, because then you're just changing for everyone, or you're becoming someone else for someone for every person you meet. And next thing you know, you don't even know who you are anymore.
Yeah, it's complex. And, you know, it's easier for us to say, you know, just stand up again and off you go. Even if you fall, keep going. But rejection is personal. It's someone telling you personally that you're not good enough. Yeah. And it's going to hurt. And for some people, how they defend themselves is to go, all right, well, I'll give them what they want. I'll give people what they want. And I'll turn into that. And it might work. It might work for a while. It might even work long term. But it depends on what that's actually doing to you and to who you want to be. And again, it goes back to looking at yourself and creating some sort of flexibility and balance. You know, there might be elements that we need to change in order to fit in society, fit in with others. But as long as that doesn't, you know, impact the true core of who we are.
Right. And, you know, your research, of course, you speak about the things that we do to sabotage love. But before we get there, why are we seeing, because I read somewhere recently, I was talking to someone on the podcast, about how during the lockdown and resulting things opening up and people being at home, there was a significant rise in domestic abuse. I don't know if that's something you cover in your work, but maybe, you know, just from the point of relationships, why are we seeing more and more of this, where people are, I mean, we have a lot more resources to help people, and I don't know if you want to go into the psychology of why do people get into it and stay in it, but why are we seeing an increase of this sense of abuse? And I know maybe the stats probably point more towards men abusing women, but there are also some women abusing men. But just in a sense of why are more and more people finding themselves in an abusive relationship?
Yeah, look, the pandemic brought upon us a very complex situation, because people that were in a relationship with the potential to you know, to be abused or to have violence were put into enclosed space without the possibility of connecting with others or even getting out physically of the house. And that meant that what was already there in the pot stirring, you know, just boiled over. And what I'm trying to say here is that, you know, if you were already in that relationship with the potential for abuse, you were then locked, told that you couldn't go out, told that you had to, you know, face each other 24/7. And without the skills to deal with conflict, without the skills to deal with what was already there, it becomes really difficult for people to overcome those challenges. So it's not that those issues are happening more, getting or being created more, is that without the skills to deal with it, we are going to see them boil over more and more. And look, in the end of the day, is what we have been talking about here, is we are looking for those connections, and the way in which we create them and the way in which we experience them, sometimes it's not healthy. But who is to say that's not a connection? It is a connection. And if there is the possibility for us to treat it, to use skills to help those people be healthy in their relationships, we should try that first. But if that isn't, then we need to look for ways to keep individuals healthy separately before they can be connected.
Right. You know, a lot of the things you have said and you know, what I've gathered from is a lot of it starts from you as an individual. And until you establish that comfort, the value system that you are irrespective of what you do, then it's very difficult to find a solid foundation from which you can connect with people around you, right? And it could be with anyone. If you have a very sort of manipulative relationship with friends or family, then it's you know, and there's something I noticed personally is that after many years of knowing people, whether it's from school or whether it's family members, right, whether it's cousins, if you don't take a step back from that relationship, you don't look at the nature of the relationship, whether it's one person kind of whether it's healthy or unhealthy, you kind of just take it for granted, going, no, I've known him for 25 years, it can't be bad. But it could be, right? Because it's leading in a direction where if if you're willing to change, then that person who changes with you unknowingly or knowingly, then that relationship grows. But many times it's stagnant, right? It's static. And if you change, that person tries to bring you back to what they are comfortable with you being in that relationship. So until you actually sometimes take a good hard look, it's like, you know, very basic analogies, like cutting dead branches of a tree. But how important is it to look at the relationships in your life every so often and say, hey, let's take stock. Is this person actually healthy for me, or are we just with them because, you know, we are BFFs?
Look, I think that's very important. But one complex factor in how relationships work and how we work as individuals is that it's not linear. So it's not about look at yourself, then get into a relationship or you know, vice versa. It all happens at the same time in a very messy way.
Yeah.
So it might be that you are looking at yourself and working on yourself, but you're already in a relationship. And so, yeah, we can't be inflexible in thinking that, you know, we do A and then we do B and then we do C and there's that one beautiful journey. It's going to be messy and you might have to do it all at the same time. And there might be kids and there might be parents or there might be even sick relatives that you are looking after at the same time as you're doing all of these and work. But it's tackling it all, I guess.
Right. No, because of course, you know, it would be lovely if you could just put it all in a journal and say, you know what, I want points A to Z to follow in that order. Of course, we would all love that. But I think the chaos in some way adds to the magic of it all, which sometimes is painful. But when you come out on the other side, it seems, wow, okay, it worked out. But
yeah, and it's also that, you know, being kind to yourself that you might see a lot of progress, you know, as you work through your relationships or if you work on yourself. But there might be, you know, steps back and then you go again. So it's being flexible that you are going to go back and forth and sideways and be patient.
Yeah, I think that's so important to remember because we, you know, we've been told these stories of how love looks and how it should work out, but it's not never the case. But how much of an influence does what you've seen a relationship growing up, how much influence does it have on your idea of a relationship? I don't know if that's a clear enough question, but what I mean is, you know, when you look at people older than you, whether it's your parents or your siblings, if they're older than you, or if it's your uncles and aunts or whoever it may be, and how much does that shape what you want from a relationship, and how does that shape how you value a relationship, and how you approach a relationship?
Yeah, look, we know that the evidence is robust on the fact that we do get meaningful, that those experiences are meaningful in shaping how we understand love and connections. I can't quantify how much that is, but I can tell you that for the positives and for the negatives, we are watching how others connect around us. So we start by watching how our parents connect, how our caregivers connect, and then even how our siblings are connecting, our friends, how we have connected in the past with our previous relationships. We are watching it all. For some people, it might be that they've got really good role models in their lives, and they know what love looks like. They know what it takes, and that's great. But for others, it might be that they need to overcome that barrier first. So they don't have good role models. They don't have good relationships around them. They only know what not to do. So I often talk about the fact that when it comes to intimate relationships, we actually need to learn skills to be in those relationships. It's not something that we download automatically. Just like we need to learn how to write and talk and walk, for some of us, you need to learn how to be with someone else because you've never been taught that or you've never had the opportunity to observe that. But either way, we are, yes, we are looking around, we are taking it in, and sometimes we learn the wrong lessons and we need to reshape those messages as we go along.
Yeah, that's lovely, actually, learning how to be with someone, because that's something you never realize that you know or don't know, right? Yeah. Because you're kind of just forced into school with other kids or you're in these environments, but you never think about it. And subconsciously, you're like, yeah, I saw this is how Rachel and Ross were dating on Friends. And, you know, who knows the examples that you apply to your life. But this shows how old I am, because I was giving Friends references.
No, we learn from TV shows. Yeah. We learn from Disney. We learn from everything. We learn from books that we read. So, that's what makes it so difficult, I think, for kids these days, is that they've got a lot more exposure to messages than I did, I think, because of the internet and online spaces. So there are plenty of schools for them. Whether or not those messages are good, that's a different story.
Right. And you speak about this in your talk about the four elements that people use to sabotage love. How relevant is that when it comes to these platforms, and especially this generation that is exposed at such a young age to such a vast number of quote-unquote connections, vast number of inputs from other people, vast number of comments about how they look, who they are, what they think that they should be? So how do you put that context into this situation? How do you put this situation into those elements of what people use to sabotage love?
Oh, look, because there's so much out there, you've got to be critical. If you're looking for ways to learn how to be with someone and how not to sabotage a relationship, for example, and you are in the dark web and just finding so much.
Sorry, could you just talk about the four elements of the sabotage before we move forward? Because of people who, I'm sure they listen to the talk, but just for the context we're going to set now.
Yeah. So Gottman has proposed four ways in which people deal with issues in relationships and potentially sabotage them. So that would be criticism, defensiveness, stonewalling, and contempt as well. So those are ways in which those are armors and tools that we use in ways that we interact with our partners. And I see that very often in relationships.
Right. So you said these four things: criticism, stonewalling, you have contempt, and then you have insecure self. Did you say self-worth?
Defensiveness.
So now if we use that in the context of it's happening in real time, right? There's criticism, people constantly bullying and whatever form of criticism, right? It could be it's not a sat down, you know, I think what you said was hurtful, or it's just like, you're not worth it, you get off my screen, or you're cancelled, or defense. So you said these are things that we use as armor, these are layers that we use to protect ourselves. But it's in itself so difficult to kind of, you know, get past each layer. But how does one even, I don't know, like how does that fit in with this present day scenario?
Not sure I know what you mean. I think the importance of that work and what that work has highlighted is that there are some more prominent ways, especially in romantic relationships, in which we defend ourselves. So if we, for example, if we're talking about the fear of getting hurt and wanting to protect ourselves, one way that people will often do that, and for you to be able to identify and visualize that's actually happening, is through criticism. So I'm feeling afraid that I might get hurt or I might be attacked. I'm going to do that first. I'm going to tell you what's wrong with you so you don't see what's happening over here. So we know that's a very, common way in which people defend themselves. For others, that might not be how they do it. So they might stonewall. So they might distance themselves altogether. So they see conflicts coming and then just run the opposite direction. So those are just tools that people use in relationships often to protect themselves and to make sure that they are not the ones getting hurt in the first place. Now, it varies from person to person, but those four ones are the most common types of ways in which people will do that. And defensiveness is such a complex phenomenon because it's feeling attacked in the first place. And sometimes the attack is coming and it is happening. And other times, which is often what I see in my research, it's a perceived attack that might be coming, that could happen, that might not even happen at all, but we have already put everything in place to defend just in case.
No, it's so true because you build this, you have this anticipation, right? If they say this, I'm going to say this, then I'm going to react, and nothing ever happens, right? Sometimes. Now, what I was trying to just sort of draw a relationship with is, you know, these things you mentioned, being defensive, being open to criticism or resist criticism or stonewalling. Yeah, it between people it happens maybe one on one, or you know, there's the notion of getting stubborn, whatever. But when someone from a young age who's exposed to trolls or exposed to all these online things that are these tools are coming in handy there, right? They are stonewalling, they're ignoring it, or they're refusing to handle criticism, which may not be good or may be good because they're like, you know what, I'm right. And if you don't suit what I think, like, you're off my list of people I interact with. So when it's being done at such a strong level, at such a young age, at such a formative time, then isn't it even more hard to strip away when you're trying to be vulnerable with someone?
Absolutely, and that's why it's so complex. Because, as I said before, in order to be able to connect with someone in a meaningful way, you have to be vulnerable, right? But if danger is coming, you do need to protect yourself. So those tools are tools that we might have to use in different points in our lives. Because if there is danger, you do have to protect yourself, and it might be that you need to walk away from a situation. And distance yourself because that's not healthy for you. So the message here is that those tools are there for a reason. I would never say to someone, don't use them ever. It's just about if you are trying to connect and love someone and show love for someone, those are not the tools that you pick up.
That's nice because those are tools for self-preservation, but they don't come in, they're not tools you use to build a relationship.
Yeah, it depends if you are in times of love or war.
Think we're right now in times of war. Anyhow,
Yeah,
Raquel, it's been so lovely chatting with you, and I really appreciate you taking the time to share your work and
likewise, thank you.
it's been lovely. And I think you put out a lot of articles on this topic and topics which are related to this. I'll link that to your website. I think that's where all your articles are.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for joining me, and really appreciate you taking the time today.
Yes, thank you.